Hello everyone. In this video, we're going to be conversing about the speech act theory in pragmatics and thereby exploring the meaning of utterances in context. Let's get started. Okay, so speech act is definitely within the purview of discourse analysis. It is actually the smallest unit of discourse. So when we're dealing with discourse analysis, when we're trying to analyze discourse, we may start with speech acts. And when we're talking about speech acts, they're actually part of pragmatics. Pragmatics is a branch of linguistics, and it studies how context affects meaning, or how utterances are interpreted in certain situations. That is pragmatics. So take this example. When somebody in a room says, "It's very hot in here." So that's the statement or the utterance produced by the speaker. When we are trying to get the meaning, we may understand that the literal meaning of that utterance is to inform that the temperature in the room is very high, right? So when I'm saying it's very hot in here, it means that I'm informing my listener that the temperature in the room is very high. So that's the literal meaning. And then we have the pragmatic meaning. So when we try to go deeper into the meaning of the utterance itself, we might try to see what the speaker is actually trying to do with the utterance. So what is the intention of the speaker? Why does the speaker say so? Why does the speaker say it's very hot in here? Then the pragmatic meaning that we might get is that the speaker might ask for help. The speaker might be asking somebody to turn on the air conditioner or perhaps to open the window because it's very hot, right? So that's like the intention, the real intention, or the action that the speaker is actually doing with the utterance. That is pragmatic meaning. And let's focus on pragmatic meaning more through, you know, the discussion about speech acts. Now, what is speech act? Speech act is a basic unit in discourse analysis, and it is the functional or the communicative value of utterances to perform actions. That is the definition of speech act. And when we are talking about speech act theory, it was first proposed by J.L. Austin in about 1962. And he further categorized speech act into three levels. In the first level, we have locutionary act. Locutionary act is the utterance and its literal meaning. So for example, when I say it's very hot in here, the utterance itself, it's very hot in here, is my locutionary act. And the literal meaning, like what we've discussed earlier, that I'm informing that the temperature is very high, is the literal meaning. And thus, it's a part of locutionary act. So, locutionary act is the utterance and its literal meaning. And the next one, we have illocutionary act. It's the speaker's intention in making the utterance or the pragmatic meaning. So, in our previous example, asking for help, asking for somebody to turn on the air conditioner or to open the window, would be the illocutionary act or the pragmatic meaning, right? And the third one, we have perlocutionary act. Perlocutionary act is the effect or the result of the utterance on the listener or the reader. So for example, if my illocutionary act is to ask for help from somebody to turn on the air conditioner or to open the window, then the expected perlocutionary act would be that somebody or that other person opening the window or turning on the AC. That's going to be the perlocutionary act. It's the action by the listener or the reader being influenced by my utterance. Now I'm going to show you a video from a series entitled The Big Bang Theory, and it's a conversation between Leonard, this person is Leonard, and Sheldon is Sheldon. Now let's have a look and try to identify the locutionary, illocutionary, and perlocutionary acts.
Want to get that?
Not particularly.
Could you get that?
I suppose I could if I were asked.
Would you please get that?
Of course. Why do you have to make things so complicated?
Dr. Cooper.
Yes?
I'm Special Agent Page, FBI.
You say you're Special Agent Page, FBI.
Here's my ID.
And here is my Justice League membership card. But that doesn't prove I know Batman.
I just want to ask you a few questions about Howard Wolowitz.
Oh, all right. I doubt anyone would risk the stiff penalties for impersonating a federal officer just to ask questions about a minor league engineer with an unresolved Oedipal complex.
Okay, so from the video, we can see that the locutionary acts are three, actually. So there are three locutionary acts. Leonard said, "Wanna get that?" at first. And then he later said, "Could you get that?" And lastly, he said, "Would you please get that?" So those are the three locutionary acts performed by Leonard. And from the video, we can see that Sheldon didn't really understand the illocutionary act performed by the previous two locutionary acts. And that's why Leonard had to repeat the locutionary acts up to the third one. So finally, Leonard said, "Would you please get that?" And after that, Sheldon understood that the illocutionary act was actually that Leonard asked for help from Sheldon to open the door. So that is the illocutionary act. So when performing those three locutionary acts, Leonard did not intend to just, you know, ask about Sheldon's ability to open the door. But in that case, Leonard was actually intending to ask for help from Sheldon. Yeah. Leonard was, you know, trying to ask for help from Sheldon to open the door. Yeah. And then thirdly, we have the perlocutionary act. It is actually illustrated by Sheldon's action of opening the door. Yeah. So it's a result or it's an effect of the illocutionary act. Okay, now let's get to the homework. And for the homework, I'd like you to watch another video from the Big Bang Theory. And now it's a conversation between Sheldon, right here, and Raj, right here. So they're having lunch, and then Raj is talking to Sheldon, and there's something funny in the video. And the question for the homework is this. So try to answer the question here. Yeah. So the question is, what makes the scene funny? Use the speech act theory to explain your answer. So I'm going to play the video right now, and then please submit your answer via e-class.
Hold on, Sheldon, is that ketchup on the table?
Yes, there is. But here's a fun fact. Ketchup started out as a general term for sauce, typically made of mushrooms or fish brine with herbs and spices. Some popular early main ingredients included blueberry, anchovy, oyster, kidney bean, and grape.
No, that's okay, I'll get it.